إنا نخاف من ربنا يوما عبوسا قمطريرا فوقاهم الله شر ذلك اليوم ولقاهم نضرة وسرورا وجزاهم بما صبروا جنة وحريرا متكئين فيها على الأرائك لا يرون فيها شمسا ولا زمهريرا.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. وبعد، فعنوان هذه المحاضرة بإذن الله تبارك وتعالى بيان فضل العلم الشرعي ووصايا نافعة لطلاب العلم الشرعي.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. شيخي began by reciting some verses from خطبة الحاجة, declaring the oneness of Allah and the peace and salutations of blessings upon our Nabi and our Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said after this, the title of today's lecture, this discussion, is about the virtues of Islamic or religious knowledge and some words of advice for the student who wants to be a student of knowledge.
لا يخفى على الجميع أن الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام في السنة الصحيحة قد جاءت فيها نصوص صحيحة صريحة في بيان فضل العلم الشرعي أو طلب العلم الشرعي. من ذلك ما قصه الله تبارك وتعالى في قصة الخضر مع موسى عليه السلام، من قول موسى عليه السلام الخضر: قال هل أتبعك على أن تعلمني مما علمت رشدا.
The Sheikh, he began by saying that it does not escape anyone here the many proofs that come to us from the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla and the authentic sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in regards to the many nasus, where those nasus are authentic and they are clear, that show and indicate the virtue of getting knowledge and the superiority of the person who preoccupies himself with getting knowledge. And from that is the story of Khidr and Musa, when Allah Ta'ala mentioned that Musa said to Khidr, would you allow me? Should I not follow you? Can I follow you so that you can teach me from what you have learned?
وقال النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام نظر الله امرأ سمع مقالتي فوعاها فأداها كما سمعها فرب مبلغ أوعى من سامع.
Another proof is the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he said, may the face of the person be illuminated, the one who hears my speech, and then he understood it and he memorized it and he relayed it the same way he heard it. Because it may be that the person who is relayed to understands it better than the one who heard it.
وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله به طريقا إلى الجنة.
Another proof that shows the virtue of knowledge and getting knowledge is the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Anyone who goes out in search of knowledge, Allah will make easy for him as a result of what he's doing the path to al-Jannah.
وقد نص العلماء أن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قد دعا ربه بأدعية كثيرة، ولكن لم يرد نص في بيان طلب الزيادة بشيء إلا بالعلم، وقل ربي زدني علما.
The scholars of Islam, إخواني, they have mentioned that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made dua to Allah for many, many things. But there is nothing that comes to us that shows us that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made a dua to get an addition of anything other than the addition of knowledge. The Quran said that the Prophet should say, O my Lord, increase me in knowledge.
وهذا العلم الذي وردت فيه النصوص في بيان فضله هو العلم الشرعي، والعلم الشرعي إما آية محكمة من القرآن أو حديث صحيح من السنة المطهرة أو أثر من آثار الصحابة والسلف الصالح.
The Sheikh said the knowledge that we're talking about here, we're talking about the virtues of knowledge and the virtues of the person getting knowledge. He said the knowledge that we're talking about here is the knowledge of the Sharia, the knowledge of the Deen. That's what we're referring to right here. He said when we talk about knowledge of the Deen, it consists of a knowledge of an ayah from the Quran that is clear. Knowledge that comes from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that's sahih. And knowledge that comes from the athar of the people who came before us.
ولذلك يقول ابن القيم رحمه الله العلم قال الله قال رسوله قال الصحابة هم أولو العرفان. والعلماء بيّنوا أن العلم هو معرفة الحق بدليله. العلم هو أن تعرف الحق بدليله.
The Sheikh, he said, based upon what we just mentioned, that knowledge of the Sharia is talking about the ayat that's clear, the hadith that's sahih, and the athar of the Sahaba. Ibn al-Qayyim, the great scholar, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned in some lines of poetry the same thing. He said, knowledge is what Allah said and what his messenger said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what the companion said. The Sheikh, he went on to mention that the definition that that the scholars give for knowledge is knowing the truth with its proofs. Knowing the haq, knowing the truth, and knowing the proofs of that truth.
يأتي الآن السؤال لماذا الحرص أو لماذا نحث أو لماذا نهتم بطلب العلم الشرعي؟
The Sheikh, he said he wants to put forth a question, and that is, what's the reason, what's the wisdom? Why would we go after and research and study religious knowledge? Why do we do that?
السبب الأول أن ننال بهذا العلم خشية الله تبارك وتعالى ويزداد بها إيماننا.
He said, number one, the first reason why we do that, so that we can acquire and we can get the fear of Allah, the khashya of Allah, and so that our faith can be increased.
كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء. والنبي عليه الصلاة والسلام عندما جاء ثلاثة النفر إلى بيته والقصة طويلة قال أما إني أعلمكم بالله وأخشاكم لله. فرتب النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام الخشية على العلم بالله تبارك وتعالى.
Another proof of that is the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the reason why we get knowledge and go after knowledge is because we want to get khashya of Allah, we want to increase our faith. The proof of that is the statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran, verily those people who fear Allah from His servants are the ulama, the people who have knowledge, they have the khashya. And another proof of that is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the authentic hadith where the three people came to his house. And the hadith is long, but what we want to take up from this hadith is that he said to those three people, as for me, then I have the most knowledge, the most ilm, I have the most knowledge, and I have the most khashya. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam connected khashya with knowledge, and it shows they go together.
واما السبب الثاني او الحكمه الثانيه من طلب العلم وهي مهمه جدا انك تستطيع ان تعبد الله عز وجل على بصيره وعلى هدى. فالبصيره والهدى هي العلم الشرعي كما قال عز وجل قل هذه سبيلي ادعو الى الله على بصيره انا ومن اتبعني. فطلب العلم الشرعي يعطيك هذه البصيرة وهذه الهدى حتى تعبد الله تبارك وتعالى.
The Sheikh said the second reason why we get knowledge is so that, and this second reason is really important, and it is so that we can worship Allah and we know what we're doing. We worship Him with basira, we know what we're doing, and with huda, we know we worship Him based upon guidance. Like the ayat of the Quran said, the ayat commanded, say, this is my way, this is my sabil. I call to Allah with basira, me and those who follow me. So the Sheikh went on to say, so this goes to show that if you get knowledge, it will give you the ability to give dawah or to do your worship in accordance to what's correct with knowledge.
بهذه البصيرة يستطيع الإنسان أن يميز بين الحق والباطل وبين الشرك والتوحيد وبين السنة والبدعة وبين أمور كثيرة. بهذه البصيرة بهذا العلم الشرعي يستطيع الإنسان يقول أن يميز بين ما أراده الله عز وجل منه من التوحيد وبين ما حذر الله منه وهو الشرك. أيضا كذلك السنة والبدعة، كيف تميز بين هذين الأمرين المتضادين إلا بالعلم الشرعي.
Concerning the previous issue number two and about al-basira and worshiping Allah and knowing what you're doing, the Sheikh said that when the person gets knowledge, then he's able to distinguish and differentiate between the truth and falsehood, between shirk and tawheed. He'll be able to tell the difference between the sunnah and innovation. He'll be able to tell the difference between the opposites that are in front of him. He said, if an individual has knowledge, he puts himself in the position where he has the ability to do this particular thing, to identify things and to know their opposites.
وأما السبب الثالث والأخير فالإنسان يستطيع بطلب العلم أن يتحصن ويتقي فتن الشبهات. فتن، الفتن أنواع، نوعان مهمان، إما فتنة في الشبهة أو فتنة في الشهوة. الشهوة المعصية والذنب، هذا فتنة شهوة. والقسم الآخر فتن الشبهات، الشكوك والشبهات في دين الله عز وجل، لن يستطيع الإنسان أن يتقيها إلا باليقين وهو العلم الشرعي.
Sheikh said the number three reason and the last one, why do we get knowledge? He said we get knowledge because knowledge will enable an individual to avoid and to be far away from the shubahat, the ambiguous affairs, the things that cause doubt, that cause shakuk in a person's mind. He said there are different types of challenges. He said that we have the challenge of the shubha and the challenge of the shahwa. He said that the shahwa is the ma'asiyah, the mistakes that people make. Whereas the shubahat, they are those things that put a person in doubt. They are the things that cause shakuk in the mind of the individual. He said these shubahat, they can be avoided unless a person has knowledge to be protecting himself from those things.
وصايا عامة إلى طالب العلم. الوصية الأولى وجوب الإخلاص في طلب العلم، بمعنى أن يكون الطلب لوجه الله تبارك وتعالى وليس لحظ الدنيا أو شهادة أو مال أو أي شهوة، إنما المراد من طلب العلم أن تبتغي بذلك وجه الله تبارك وتعالى، كما قال عز وجل وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله مخلصين له الدين.
The Sheikh said concerning the next issue, after dealing with three reasons why we get knowledge, we go on to another issue, and that is the wasaya or the words of advice that he wants to deliver to you, why we should get knowledge and the virtues of knowledge. He said the first thing when you want to get knowledge is you should understand the importance of, number one, having ikhlas and having sincerity, that you do this thing solely for the wajh or the face of Allah, for Allah to be pleased with you. Your goal and your objective is not for the dunya. Your goal and your objective is not for your shahada, getting the paper of graduation, a degree. The goal and objective is not for an individual to get money or to have shuhra, to become well known, but instead solely and strictly for Allah's pleasure, as Allah said in the Quran, and they have not been ordered to do anything except to worship Allah with ikhlas and to establish his religion like that.
من الأدلة على هذه الوصية بعد هذه الآية حديث عظيم وخطير في أول ثلاثة تسعر لهم النار، منهم رجل عالم، فلما سئل يوم القيامة لماذا طلبت العلم؟ قال حتى أدعو إلى دينك يا رب، وحتى قالوا فقال الله له كذبت، إنما تعلمت ليقال عالم أي في الدنيا، وقد قيل خذوه إلى النار. فدلالة على أن النية أمرها مهم جدا، فما الإنسان إذا ابتغى بهذا العلم الدنيا ومدح الناس وثناء الناس فسيسعر به في جهنم العياذ بالله.
The Sheikh said also in addition to this ayah that we just used to show the importance of al-ikhlas is the long hadith about the first three people who are going to be questioned yawm al-qiyamah. From those three people is a man who had knowledge, and it would be said to him, why did you get knowledge? The man will say, I got knowledge in order to worship you, so that the people could see you as being the one who should be worshipped. It would be said to that man, you lied. You got knowledge so that the people would praise you, and they did praise you. Now go to the hellfire, and it will be put in the hellfire. The Sheikh said this is a clear indication and a clear proof that if an individual's niyyah, his goal, his objective in getting knowledge is for people to praise him, his goal and the objective is to get some recognition from the people, then the end result of that is the hellfire.
الوصية الثانية أن تحرص يا طالب العلم على أن تطلب العلم على صاحب سنة أن تطلب العلم على صاحب اتباع وأثر وسنة. إذن هناك نوعان من إن صح التعبير من العلماء، عالم على السنة وعالم على غير عالم مبتدع. فأنت كطالب العلم ينبغي أن تحرص أن تلزم صاحب السنة تدرس عليه العلم الشرعي. فالوصية الثانية أن تحرص أن تنال العلم من صاحب سنة.
The Sheikh said number two from my advice to you from the wasaya that a student of knowledge should receive in here. After ikhlas, he should make it his business to get knowledge from a person who is a person of the sunnah, a person who has al-ittiba, the person who is upon the athar and the sunnah. Al-ittiba means that he's following the right way, he's following the sunnah. The Sheikh says, so we have two types of people you can get knowledge from. You get knowledge from a scholar, a person who is a person of innovation, or you get knowledge from an individual who is a person who has knowledge and he's of the people of the sunnah. So we should make it so that we have hirs, an ardent desire to get the person and find the person who's the person of the sunnah.
ولذلك حذر السلف وهذا موضوع مهم جدا حذر السلف من تلقي العلم عن المبتدعة تحذر السلف من تلقي العلم عن المبتدعة وذكروا أسبابا يعني مهمة جدا في بيان المآثر السيئة الآثار السيئة عندما يتلقى الإنسان طلب العلم من صاحب سنة من المبتدع. واحد، الآن سنذكر المفاسد والآثار السيئة من طلب العلم على المبتدعة. واحد، أن هذا الطالب قد يتعلق قلبه بهذا الشيخ، والتعلق بالشيخ على غير السنة إذا المبتدع هذا أمره خطير جدا. إذن لا يجوز، لأن سيتعلق مع طول المدة وطول التحصيل العلمي سيتعلق قلبه بهذا الشيخ، ولا شك أن هذا الشيخ خالف سنة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فينبغي أن يهجر أو أن يترك. نعم.
The Sheikh he mentioned إخواني that concerning this second wasiyah, many of the people from the Salaf, from the righteous predecessors, they used to warn the students of knowledge, they used to warn the community of taking knowledge from an innovator. He said this issue is really important, it's critical, serious. He said the seriousness and the danger of taking knowledge from a mubtadi', a person of innovation, is a crucial one that people should be aware of. And there are many reasons why it should be avoided. He's going to give us a few reasons why you shouldn't take knowledge from a person who is a mubtadi', but you have to take knowledge from a person who is sahib al-sunnah. The first reason he said. Now this is the second wasiyah, and in the second wasiyah, take knowledge from a person of the sunnah, not mubtadi'. Now he's going to talk about the danger of taking knowledge from a mubtadi'. First reason. He said that the student, if a student were to take knowledge from a sheikh who's a mubtadi', then his heart, after some time, is going to become connected and attached to what that man is upon. And if that happens, then there's going to be a problem. So that's the first danger.
إذا تعلق قلبه بالمبتدع قد هذا الشيخ يعني يجري عليه بعض البدع والانحرافات من خلال هذا التدريس وهو لا يشعر. الإنسان الطالب إذا تعلق بالمبتدع فيأخذ منه كل شيء، فقد يستغل هذا الشيخ هذا التعلق من هذا الطالب فيعطيه بعض البدع والانحرافات ويخلطها مع ما يتعلمه من السنة فينحرف هذا الطالب. فمن خطورتها أن قد يخلط عليه الشيخ هذه البدع وهو لا يعلم.
The Sheikh said, now the problem with his heart becoming connected to that Sheikh who's a mubtadi', we get another issue. And the second problem is, if his heart becomes connected to that Sheikh who he's taking knowledge from who's mubtadi', then that Sheikh will start to give him innovations that he himself will start to do. And he may not even realize that he's doing innovation because he is affected by that Sheikh who is teaching him in the first place. So then he starts to fall into inhirafat, where he's going off the mark and he's doing things of innovation that are not acceptable. And again, he may not even realize it.
أيضا من الآثار السيئة على طالب العلم على المبتدع أننا نكذب أو يعني يسمونه إغرار العامة بصحة ما عليها المبتدع. يعني سأشرح بالشيء الشيخ يفهم. يعني كثرة الجلوس مع المبتدعة سيغر العامة العوام الناس أن هذا الشيخ على 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 طريقة صحيحة ولو ولا لما ذهب إليه الإنسان الطلب عنده العلم. فكثرة الجلوس عند المبتدعة قد تغر العامة بصحة ما عليه هذا المبتدع.
الشيخ said number three from the bad athar, the bad effects of getting knowledge from the wrong people like a person of innovation is that there's going to be some lies that are going to be told. And he said, I'm going to explain to you what I mean by that. He said, for an example, if a person is sitting with a person of innovation and he continues to sit with them, then the general masses are going to look at that situation and they're going to think that what that sheikh is teaching is the correct thing, when in fact what he's teaching is not correct. So when you see a lot of people sitting around him, other people may be fooled. They may be tricked into believing what he's upon is something that is beneficial, but he's upon innovation.
طيب الآن الوصية قلنا الوصية الأولى الإخلاص والثانية طلب علم على صاحب سنة. الوصية الثالثة أن يهتم الطالب بموضوع الحفظ. يعني أكثر ما يعين على الطلب وتثبيت الطلب العلمي هو الحفظ, أن يكون له ملكة تعود الحفظ. طبعا الحفظ يعني هو أن يبدأ بالقرآن, حفظ القرآن ثم حفظ الحديث. إذن الوصية الثالثة وصية بالحفظ.
The third advice. First one is ikhlas, being sincere. Second one, getting knowledge from purpose and sunnah. Third one is that the student has to be ready. He has to be able. He has to want to memorize. He has to memorize because memorization is going to help him. He has to memorize from the book of Allah, the Quran, and he has to memorize what he can memorize from the authentic ahadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
طيب الآن ما هي الأمور المعينة على الحفظ؟ ما هي الأمور المعينة على تسهيل الحفظ؟
Now the Sheikh, he wants to give you what are some of the things that you can do to take care of this third wasiyah. How can you be helped? What can you do to increase your ability to memorize?
الأمر الأول الكتابة. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قيدوا العلم بالكتابة. فإذا حضرت محاضرة أو درسا يكون معك نوت صغيرة أو مذكرة صغيرة تقيد الفوائد المهمة من الشيخ والمحاضرة. إذن أول شيء الكتابة, قيدوا العلم بالكتابة.
The Sheikh said first thing that will help you to memorize is that you have to write. You have to write. And that's based upon the hadith where the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said قيدوا, like تقييد of the knowledge. It means hold on to the knowledge, grasp the knowledge, get the knowledge, help yourself by writing. So that means when you come to the lesson, bring with you a notebook. So when you hear the lesson, you can write down some of the beneficial points that you heard through the lesson.
الأمر الثاني التعاهد. يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تعاهدوا القرآن. يعني أكثر من الرجوع إلى المحافظة عليه أول بأول. التعاهد أن تجعل بينك وبين القرآن عهدا, كان في رباط. كلما ابتعدت ترجع تراجع. فالتعاهد أمره مهم جدا. أما إذا تركت القرآن أول حديث ستنسى هذا العلم.
Number two, what are the things that you can do to help you to memorize? He said to make what is known as a ta'ahud. A ta'ahud is when you do something and you keep doing, you repeat it, it's repetitive. Like the Prophet said about the Quran sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he commanded the people, keep going over and keep rehearsing the Quran so that it'll stay with you. The Sheikh went on to mention that the more you do something, the more it's going to stay with you. So the ahd is for you to be connected to that thing as if it's almost like a rope between you and it. He said this is extremely important in the way of trying to memorize.
الأمر الثالث من الأسباب عنا للحفظ ترك المعاصي. ترك المعاصي. المعصية ظلمة وهي سبب للنسيان. كل ما حفظ الإنسان آية أو سورة أو حديثا أو كذا لو استهان بالمعاصي فالمعاصي لها آثار سيئة على قلب الإنسان ومنها نسيان هذا العلم.
The Sheikh said number three, if a person wants to memorize, then let him abandon doing sins, doing the ma'asi, disobeying Allah Azza wa Jalla. He said because the ma'asi, sins, they are darkness. There's cause for darkness. And every time a person, he sins, the end result of that could be that he forgets an ayat that he used to memorize. He forgets a surah that he used to memorize. He forgets a hadith that he used to memorize. So the one who makes istihana with the ma'asi, he looks at the ma'asi and the sins as being small and not considered to be big. He said the end result of that is, the direct impact is that your memory will be affected.
ولذلك نقل عن الإمام مالك رحمه الله وأنه قال للشافعي إني أرى أن الله عز وجل ألقى على قلبك نورا فلا تطفئه بظلمة المعصية.
And for this reason, it is reported and recorded that Al-Imam Malik, he said to Al-Imam al-Shafi, Al-Imam Malik said to Al-Imam al-Shafi, I see that Allah has given you knowledge, nur. He was giving him advice. Allah has blessed you with nur. He said, don't extinguish that light and put it out by sinning and disobeying Allah.
الأمر أو الوصية الرابعة انتهينا من موضوع الحفظ. الوصية الرابعة يجب المداومة والاستمرار في طلب العلم حتى تلقى الله عز وجل. يعني أن طلب العلم ليس له حد. طلب العلم ليس له حد. عليك أن تستمر في الطلب حتى تلقى الله تبارك وتعالى.
Number four, concerning the advice to the student of knowledge, is that the student of knowledge should understand that he has to and she has to search for knowledge until the day that you meet Allah Azza wa Jal. That there is absolutely no point where you stop in getting knowledge. That it is with al-mudawama and istimrar. That is continual and is no breaks in between. That it is something that is to be done until the individual meets Allah, meaning he dies.
طيب من الأقوال المشهورة عن العلماء تؤكد هذا اللي هو على الاستمرار في طلب العلم ما نقل عن ابن المبارك رحمه الله قيل له إلى كم تكتب الحديث يعني إلى متى تكتب الحديث فقال رحمه الله لعل الكلمة التي أنتفع بها لم أسمعها بعد.
الشيخ he said that concerning this point how the fourth wasiyah and that is to be continuous in getting knowledge. From what some of the people said in this regard to prove that it's something that's continual. It was said to the great Imam al-Imam Abdullah bin Mubarak, until when should a person be a student and get hadith, write down the hadith? At what point does he stop? Al-Imam Abdullah bin Mubarak said to him, it may be, you ask me that question, but it may be that to this point right now, you didn't write or I didn't write the thing that will benefit you, meaning there's still more to come because you may not have benefited yet from what you've received to this point. So you have to keep going because you never know when the benefit is coming.
وأيضا كان للإمام أحمد رحمه الله محبرة يكتب بها. قيل له يا أبا عبد الله إلى متى المحبرة؟ قال من المحبرة إلى المقبرة.
الإمام أحمد, when he used to want to write his knowledge, he had a vessel that had ink in it, and he would put the thing and he would write it like that. So someone said to him, Ya Aba Abdullah, al-Imam Ahmed, until when will you continue to use this? When are you going to stop? When are you going to stop? He said, I'm going to continue to do this from the time that I'm doing it now until the time that I go on my grave, because both of the words, they rhymed. This word rhymed with the grave. So he's basically saying, I'm going to keep getting knowledge until I die.
ولذلك ثبت أيضا في بعض التراجم العلماء وهذا يعني القصد منه من هذا السرد حتى نؤكد على أن طلب العلم مستمر ولا حد له. أن بعض العلماء كان وهو على فراش الموت يحتضر ويناقش طلابه بمسائل فقهية دقيقة ويقول لهم اطرحوا لنا مسألة أو أنا أطرح لكم مسألة فيقول له الطلاب يا شيخ نحن يعني الآن في وقت أنت ضعيف وأنت مريض وأنا أخاف عليك قال له حتى يعني الإنسان يلقى الله عز وجل وقد علم طلابه مسألة فقالوا ناقشنا في مسألة معينة وكانت مريضا ومتعبا فلما انتهى من النقاش قالوا خرجنا من باب البيت فسمعنا الصراخ على موته. واضح يا شيخ؟
أيوه. Another example from what the Salaf used to be upon in proving this point that you have to get knowledge until you die is that one of the great imams from the ulama of al-Islam, he was on his deathbed. And while he was on the deathbed, he just wasn't dying on his deathbed, but he was struggling. He was in a situation where death was imminent. He was going to die. Not he was sick, he was going to die. So some of his students were around him and he was debating them and discussing with them about issues in fiqh that were very precise. Not just regular issues, but issues that were very precise with precision. So the students wanted to have some mercy on him and they say, hey, Sheikh, don't worry about this right now because you are sick, so don't worry about it. But he said, no, don't tell me, don't worry about it. And he continued to discuss with them while he was in that condition. So when they finally finished a particular issue, the last issue that they were dealing with, he told the people who were around him, you have to get knowledge until the point where you're going to meet Allah. So the people got up and they left. When they left his house, they heard the sounds coming from inside the house that indicated that the man had died. So the point here is how the Salaf used to get knowledge from one point until you meet Allah.
الوصية الخامسة وجوب العمل بالعلم. وجوب العمل بالعلم يعني لا ينفع ولا يكفي أن تتعلم العلم الشرعي وتخزنه في قلبك ولا تعمل به، فلا بد من العمل بهذا العلم. يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لن تزول قدم عبد يوم القيامة عند الله حتى يسأل عن أربع، ومنها وعن علمه ماذا عمل به.
The Sheikh said the number five wasiyah, the number five advice is that a person should get knowledge and his goal and the objective should be to work by the knowledge that he has acquired. Because it's not beneficial and it serves no purpose to get knowledge when all you're going to do with it is lock it up and not work by it. It's just something that you possess, but it's not something that is manifesting in your behavior. And for that reason, the Prophet said in an authentic hadith, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yawm al-qiyamah, the 2 feet of the slave when he's standing in front of Allah, his feet are not going to move from that place until he's asked about 4 things. And one of the 4 things that he's going to be asked about is the knowledge that he acquired and what did he do with that knowledge.
أيضا من الأدلة على هذه الوصية قول الله تبارك وتعالى خذوا ما آتيناكم بقوة قال مجاهد أي بالعمل به أي بالعمل به.
Another proof that you have to work by what you know is the command of Allah in the Quran. He said, take the book with power. Take the book with power. The great scholar Mufassir of the Quran, Mujahid, he said, the meaning of take the book with quwwah, it means work by the knowledge that you get from it.
ولذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم استعاذ وقال أعوذ بالله أو بك من علم لا ينفع.
And another indication of its importance, its seriousness and its danger all simultaneously is that the Prophet used to make a dua and he used to seek refuge in Allah. And he would say, oh Allah, I seek refuge in you from knowledge that doesn't benefit.
ونقل في أيضا في الآثار عن أحمد بن حنبل رحمه الله يقول هذا يؤكد الآن على العمل بالعلم. يقول ما كتبت حديثا إلا وقد عملت به حتى مر بي أن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام احتجم وأعطى أبا طيبة هذا الحجام اسمه أبو طيبة أعطى أبا طيبة دينارا قال فاحتجمت وأعطيت الحجام دينارا.
Another example of this point that we're trying to make is from what the Salaf used to do, and the point here is the wasiyah number 5, working by the knowledge that you have. From something that transpired with Al-Imam Ahmed ibn Hanbal rahimahullahu ta'ala, Al-Imam Ahmed said, I never would write down the hadith of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Write it down, memorize. I would never do that except I would be sure to work by the hadith that I wrote down. Even to the point that one time Al-Imam Ahmed, he saw the hadith and he came across the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did the hijama. And after doing the hijama, the man who took the blood out of him, the one who took it out, the Prophet gave him a dinar. His kunya was Abu Tayba. When Al-Imam Ahmed learned about that hadith, he went and he got hijama done, and he took a dinar and he gave it to the guy who did the hijama for him, practicing the hadith.
أيضا من الأدلة على يعني وجوب أو يعني الحرص على العمل بالعلم لأن العلم يعتبر كزكاة لهذا العمل العمل يعتبر كزكاة لهذا العلم العلم إخواني كالكنز والكنز لا بد له من زكاة والزكاة نوعان إما أن تعمل به أو تدعو الناس إليه هذه الزكاة ربع العشر العلم عبارة عن كنز والكنز لا بد له من زكاة وزكاته أمران العمل به في نفسك ودعوة الناس إليه.
The Sheikh said another issue that shows us the importance of working by the knowledge that a person acquires is that the actions that you do, it is the zakat of the knowledge. So the actions that a person does, it is the zakat of his knowledge. What does that mean? He said that knowledge is like a treasure, like a kenz, it's like a treasure chest. Knowledge is like a treasure chest, money for an example. So that treasure chest of knowledge, you have to give zakat on that wealth of knowledge that you have. So the type of zakat that you give is of two types. So the knowledge is like a treasure chest, like money, wealth of knowledge. You have to give zakat, and you can give zakat in two ways. One way that you give zakat is by working by that knowledge yourself. You work by it. The second way that you give zakat on the knowledge with zakans is you give da'wah to Allah and you call people to that knowledge that you have acquired. So you have to give the zakat for the knowledge with actions.
الوصية السادسة أن تعرف الطريقة الصحيحة في التحصيل أو طلب العلم. طلب العلم ليس هكذا دون ترتيب لا بد له من تأصيل ويقول العلماء القاعدة المشهورة من حرم الأصول حرم الوصول من حرم الأصول حرم الوصول يعني لا بد أن يكون لك أصول هناك قواعد وثوابت تبدأ فيها كالسلم خطوة خطوة ما ينبغي أن تأتي المطولات والتفريعات الفقهية وأنت لم تتأسس أصلا التأسس الصحيح إذن الطلب أيضا له ترتيب فطالب العلم لا يبدأ بالفرعيات التي هي ليس من شأنه ويترك الأصول. نعم.
Okay, إخواني, number six. The sixth advice, wasiyah, nasiha for the student of knowledge is that he has to go about getting knowledge in the proper way. The ta'seel of his knowledge, the way he's going to acquire the knowledge, he has to acquire it going about it in the right way. Because obtaining knowledge is not something that's like that. Confusion, just like that. Do what you want to do. He said that it has to be with tartib. Tartib. And that's the word Somalis know. Tartib. He said getting knowledge has to be like that. So the people of the past, they used to say a famous statement. And their statement was, whoever doesn't acquire the usul, he will be prevented from acquiring or getting the wasul. The meaning of that is, knowledge, it has qawa'id and it has dawabit, which means like rules and regulations. It has its way of going about it. The Sheikh said if a person doesn't go about it in this proper way, there are going to be some challenges. Like, for an example, someone wants to start getting knowledge and then he goes to a book that is very intense. It's from the mutawwilat. It's from the very, very expansive big books as opposed to the simple book first. You have to go step by step by step. Another example of that. A person is trying to get knowledge and he gets knowledge about something that's not from his business. It's not from his shan. This is not your issue. So don't preoccupy yourself with that.
ولذلك أنا أقول ضع لك مثل جدول. ضع جدولا كتب أول شيء باب علم العقيدة علم الفقه علم مثلا السيرة علم اللغة وتبدأ به تضع الكتب المختصرة كما قال المختصرة السمبل بسيطة هذه الكتب وتبدأ خطوة خطوة لكن لابد من الترتيب إذن في العقيدة تضع أولا كتاب صغير مختصر كذلك في الفقه كذلك في السيرة ثم تبدأ بكتاب أوسع وأوسع كلما بدأت بهذه الطريقة استطعت أن تحفظ أولا سهل ثم استطعت أن يكون عندك حصيلة علمية ركيزة علمية تعينك بعد الله عز وجل على العمل وعلى دعوة الله تبارك وتعالى.
So the reason for this is just to help you. So therefore, if you're going to go with a tertib, I would advise that you make a jadwal or a schedule for yourself. You have to make a schedule for yourself. A schedule of what you're going to learn and how you're going to go about it. For an example, you want to learn about aqidah, you want to learn about fiqh, you want to learn about seerah, okay, you make a schedule. You start off with the books that are mukhtasira, the books that are they are shortened versions, al-ikhtisar. They are the shortened version books. And then you go through those books and you go step by step with tartib. After you finish the one like that, you go to the next type of book that may be a little bit osa, a little bit wider, a little bit more difficult. The important thing is that if a person were to do it in this way, then this will help him to memorize, and it also will give him a thing in his ilmiya, his way of what he understands in a way that is comprehensive.
الوصية السابعة لا تدعو الناس إلا بعلم. الوصية السابعة لا تدعو. نحن قلنا عن الزكاة العمل والدعوة. الوصية هنا لا تدعو، لا تتكلم، لا تأمر، لا تنهى، لا توصي، لا تنصح إلا بعلم. بخلاف بعض الجماعات يقول قم يا أخي قم وأفتح عليك، لا ما ينبغي. نحن الدعوة السلفية دعوة علم، إذن ينبغي أن لا تتكلم مع الناس إلا بعلم. يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بلغوا عني ولو آية، بلغوا هذا تكليف، عني تشريف، ولو آية تخفيف. فلا تتكلم إلا بعلم. ولذلك من تكلم بجهل أو علم من غير فقه سيضر الناس أكثر مما ينفع الناس.
بلغوا هو إيش؟
بلغوا تكليف. تكليف. عني تشريف.
The Sheikh, he mentioned number seven, Ikhwani, number seven. The seventh advice that he's given to us, especially those who are writing, Barakallahu Fikum, number seven, is that you have to give dawah to the knowledge that you have. As we mentioned previously, that knowledge is something that you have to give zakat on. And one form of zakat is working by it, and the second form of zakat and knowledge is giving dawah to it. So when you get knowledge, only give dawah based upon knowledge and what you know. So don't be a person who talks. Don't be a person who makes an amr bin ma'ruf and a nahy al munkar. Don't enjoin and don't prevent. Don't enjoin the good, don't prevent the evil, except when you have knowledge. Not like some of the people who will say to someone, "Akhi, get up, give knowledge, give dawah, Allah yaftah alayk." He doesn't have any knowledge, but the person says, just get up, go ahead. It'll all come to you. Just so. He said, this is not what is correct. He said, as-salafiyyatu. As-salafiyyah is giving knowledge and calling people with knowledge. Giving knowledge, giving dawah and calling people with knowledge. The Prophet, he mentioned, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the ayah, in the hadith. He said to the people, tell the people about me, even if all you say is one ayat. The Sheikh broke down this hadith. Tell the people about me, even if it is one ayat. So the command, balighu, tell the people. This is a taklif. The Prophet made it upon us, responsibility to give dawah. Balighu, you have to do it. Talk about me. He said, this is the tashrih, explaining to the people what the Prophet said. You have to explain what's the meaning of this and what's the meaning of that. Even if it's only an ayat. And that part of the hadith goes to show a takhfif, how the religion is light and easy. You explain what is easy for you to explain. The important thing is, the one who talks without knowledge and he gives da'wah without knowledge, he'll wind up hurting the people more than he would help the people.
الوصية الثامنة ينبغي أن يحرص طالب العلم على الارتباط بالعلماء الكبار. ينبغي أن يرتبط بالعلماء الكبار، يسترشد بآرائهم، يستفتيهم، يصدر عن فتاواهم، يحترم آراءهم، لا يشنع عليهم ولا يحتقرهم، يعطيهم مكانتهم العلمية الشرعية. فالارتباط بالعلماء الكبار وخاصة في أوقات النوازل هذا من شأن طالب العلم الشرعي الصحيح. أما هو إذا رأى نفسه وافتخر بعلمه وقال أنا رأي لرأي ولهم رأيهم ويتكلم بالنوازل والدماء والجهاد وغيره وغيره فيضيع الناس، هذا ليس بطالب علم شرعي. فينبغي أن يحرص على الارتباط بالعلماء. يقول بعض السلف يقولون إن مثل العالم في البلد كمثل العين العذبة في البلد. العين العذبة الناس إذا عطشوا ارتووا منها، كذلك العالم كعين عذبة، نحن في حاجة لهم في النوازل نلجأ إليهم نستفتيهم، لا ينبغي أن نصدر بآرائنا وأذواقنا لا. فالطالب الصحيح هو الذي يحترم العلماء الكبار.
الشيخ said number 8, the advice to the student of knowledge is that the student of knowledge should connect himself very closely with the major scholars, not just the scholars, العلماء الكبار, the major scholars. You should pay attention to their opinions. You should pay attention to their fatwas. You should pay attention to their positions. And you should not be rough and tough in your words against them. You should not be a person who thinks it's right for you to give them exams, especially during the times of a nawazil, when there's fitting and problems, when they happen. This is the main time for a student of knowledge to be connected to the ulama of al-Islam. As for that individual who gets some knowledge on whatever level, and then he comes out and he starts to see himself as being the one who is knowledgeable, and he doesn't respect the position of the scholars, and he starts saying things like, they are men and I'm men, they got his opinion out of my opinion. He said, this is the one who's going to be destroyed. The one who starts to talk about big issues like the blood, issues like jihad, issues like who is correct and who's not correct. The Sheikh said, this individual, he is the one who's responsible for losing the people, making the people become lost. So the people of the past, and trying to give an indication of how important the scholar is, they said that the scholar in the city, his similitude, his similarity is like a well that has the fresh water. The people, when they get thirsty, they have to drink that water. They need that water. The scholar is the same way. Inside of the city, that scholar is like the well that's going to quench the thirst that the people have to know their religion, especially during the time of the nawazil and the fitin.
من العبارات الجميلة والمنقولة عن السلف التي تؤكد هذا حرص على الارتباط بالعلماء وأهميتهم، يقول ابن عمر، وهذا القول مهم جدا حتى نفهمه، يقول دينك إنما هو لحمك ودمك. انتبه، يقول دينك إنما هو لحمك ودمك، فانظر عمن تأخذ هذا الدين. تصور الدين كاللحم والدم، فكما أنك تهتم باللحم والدم ينبغي أن تهتم عمن تأخذ هذا الدين.
Another example that gives us how important it is, إخواني, to be connected to the العلماء الكبار is the statement of Abdullah ibn Umar, may Allah be pleased with him and his family. Ibn Umar said, your religion, your religion. He mentioned it two times for emphasis. Your religion, your religion. All it is, your religion is your blood and your meat. That's what he said. Your religion, your religion. What is it? Your religion is your blood and your meat. The Sheikh said, what's the meaning of that? He said, just as everybody here is going to pay attention to his blood and his meat, he's going to pay attention to preserving it, taking care of it. He said, the same way you have to do that with your religion. So the whole statement of Ibn Umar is, your religion, verily it is your blood and your meat, so let each and every one of you pay attention who you take your religion from. So what's the meaning of it? The meaning of that is, just as you pay attention to what you eat, what you drink, what's going to benefit you, you have to do the same way about your religion. Your religion is your blood and your meat. So be careful and be aware of who you are taking knowledge from in order to nourish your blood and your meat.
أيضا يقول عبد الله بن مسعود يقول رضي الله عنه يقول لا يزال الناس بخير ما أخذوا العلم من أكابرهم فإذا تركوهم وأخذوا عن الأصاغر هلكوا. يقول ما يزال الناس بخير ما أخذوا العلم عن أكابرهم فَإِذَا أَخَذُوا عَنِ الْأَصَاغِرِ هَلَكُوا الْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ.
Another indication from the kalam of the Salaf is what Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said about what? The importance of being connected to the scholars. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said that the community, the people, they will continue to be on a good way, in a good condition, as long as they take knowledge from their ulama, the major ones. But if they start to take knowledge from the asagir, the people who are not ulama, they start looking at these people, then they're going to be destroyed. So the statement of Ibn Mas'ud, it shows the importance of the ulama.
الوصية الثامنة الهمة في طلب العلم.
تاسعة.
الوصية التاسعة الهمة في طلب العلم. ومعنى الهمة أن يكون لك إرادة داخلية، قوة داخلية لتشجعك على الحرص على طلب العلم. ولذلك فرق بين إنسان كسلان كسول لا يعمل وبين إنسان لا بالليل والنهار جد واجتهاد وعمل بعمل دؤوب. هذه تسمى الهمة، الهمة العلمية. الآن إخواني، مع أن الأمور تيسرت، انتبه، تيسرت وسهلة جدا، إلا أن الهمم قد فترت والعياذ بالله. في السابق عبد الله أو جابر بن عبد الله سار مسيرة شهر كامل من المدينة إلى الشام حتى ينال أو يعرف حديثا واحدا فقط من المدينة إلى الشام. انظر إلى الهمة، سفر شهر كامل حتى يعرف حديثا واحدا من عبد الله بن أنيس. نكمل إن شاء الله.
The Sheikh, he said, next thing, number 9, is that the person has to have the, like they call it, ulu al-himma. In English, the best thing we could say is high determination. High determination. The Sheikh went on to explain, what is this high determination? Your nafs, something about you, something inside of you, it makes you, it encourages you, it propels you to keep moving, keep working, and not to be a person who's lazy. He said, there's a distinction and a big difference between a person who is lazy and he doesn't want to work and the other individual who is working night and day, making all efforts that he can possibly make in order to get knowledge. He said, this is the meaning. He said, right now, in the time that we're living right now, in this era right now, everything is easy. Everything is easy. You can travel, you can get, everything is easy. And yet, the high determination is not there. People have low determination. They don't want to work. Whereas in the past, the Salaf, they used to have difficulties that they had to deal with in their environments. And yet they used to have high determination. An example of that is the companion Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhumah. Jabir ibn Abdullah, he traveled all the way from Al-Madinah al-Nabawiyah all the way to Al-Sham. And that journey took him 1 month. What did he go for? He went for one hadith that he heard. He heard someone had a hadith there. He left Al-Madinah just to go and to hear that hadith. He went to get that hadith from a man by the name of Abdullah ibn Unais, and then he came back. He said that goes to show the alul himma, the high determination of those people.
إذا قارنا نحن أشرنا قبل قليل إلى الآن الوضع الآن يعني ميسور وسهل لكن الناس تكاسلوا. انظروا لهذا المثال البسيط. الآن تأتي الآن إلى جهاز الكمبيوتر أو اللابتوب أو أي جهاز، تدخل إلى جوجل، انتبه، وتختار الشيخ الذي تريده، تختار وأنت جالس في مكانك، تختار الشيخ مثلا الشيخ ابن عثيمين رحمه الله، ثم يخرج لك ماذا تريد، عقيدة، فقه، لغة، سيرة، تقول أريده وأنت جالس. ها، في السابق ما قضى الشيخ شهر كامل، الآن لا، وأنت جالس فقط الزر يعني برس ديس بوتو خلاص يطلع لك الشيخ. وبعدين أنواع العلوم، طيب لا بعد سأكمل، تختار عقيدة، ثم يقول لك الشيخ أي كتاب، كتاب التوحيد، الواسطية، تختار مثلا الواسطية. الشيخ يبدأ يتكلم وأنت تستمع وتسجل، أنت جالس في مكانك في المكتب في البيت. انتبه، أبوك يناديك يا فلان تعال، تقول الشيخ ستوب، تقول له قف، فقط الشيخ ينتظر في الجهاز وأنت تذهب إلى إيش عملك وتنتهي، ثم تقول الشيخ بلي، يكمل الشيخ. يعني حتى الشيخ يشتغل عندك، سبحان الله صح التعبير. يعني الآن أمر ميسور، حتى لو انشغلت بصلاة أو أذان أو أمر الوالد أو الوالدة، تقول للشيخ والله أنا مشغول الشيخ انتظرني قليلا، الشيخ ينتظر، تذهب ويظل الجهاز موجود على على الموقع هذا، تذهب إلى عملك، ترجع وتكمل مع الشيخ. هل في شيء أيسر من هذا؟
لا والله.
لكن أنا 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 كسل أنا كسل. نادر من يحرص على طلب العلم. نعم.
Sheikh said, I'll give you another example about what was mentioned a few minutes ago about how everything is really easy for us right now. Everything is there, it's made sore, and yet there's so much laziness that's prevalent amongst the people. He said, right now, if you take your computer, your laptop, whatever machine that you have, you're using for the internet, you go to Google, you can bring up any Sheikh that you want to bring up. The one that you choose, you can bring them up. For an example, you want to listen to a Sheikh, Muhammad ibn Salih ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullahu ta'ala. So you bring him up. He just doesn't come up, but his knowledge and what he talked about comes up with details. Do you want to do aqidah? Do you want to do fiqh? Do you want to do hadith? Do you want to do the language? And then you choose what you want to choose, and you're sitting down relaxing. Everything is easy. So you choose that you want to learn from the Sheikh something about aqidah. So you press another button about aqidah. Comes up, his explanation of kitab al-tawheed, his explanation of the aqidat al-wasatiyah, you choose. He said, now while we are sitting there and something happens, like you're learning, sitting there, comfort, your father calls you, hey, so-and-so, come here. You just take your finger and you say, Sheikh, I want you to stop right now. So you press the button and you put him on pause. Once you pause your Sheikh, you go to your father, you deal with whatever you want to deal with, you come back, you say, okay, Sheikh, you could continue. You press the button, and you're sitting there with ease, and you're listening to what he's saying. Taking notes if you want to take notes. So the Sheikh was saying that this shows you how easy things are for the people today. He went on to mention that there are a lot of things that make people busy. The adhan, the salat, the work. But you can always go to do those things, but you can always come back to take care of the easiness of knowledge that's right in front of us.
الوصية العاشرة والأخيرة لتكمل العشرة إن شاء الله أن تطلع على تراجم العلماء من السلف الصالح وكيف طلبوا العلم وحرصوا عليه حتى تتأسى به وتتشجع. لا بد من أن تطلع يعني تقرأ في تراجم العلماء السابقين كيف حرصوا على طلب العلم والأوقات كان عندهم ثمينة حتى أن من الصحابة والتابعين لهم من التراجم العجيبة لعل يذكر إن شاء الله بعد يعني قصتين أو ثلاثة من الآن بعد ما يترجم الشيخ هذه النقطة إن شاء الله.
الشيخ حفظه الله وسلمه من كل سوء ومكروه. He meant to mention point number 10 about getting knowledge, and it's the last one inshallah. Point number 10 in the way of nasiha and the wasiyah of what he wants to mention is, it is absolutely mandatory and imperative that the student of knowledge take some time out to go to look at the books that talked about the history, the biography of the ulama of the past. Those books that tell us about how they acquired knowledge and how they went about searching for knowledge and how they dealt with the issue of knowledge, how they spent everything that was important, everything that was high in, held high in regard with them. So many stories from the companions, so many stories from the tabi'een, many stories that are ajiba. Maybe we'll just do two or three right now, inshallah ta'ala.
Al-Ula, عبد الرحمن ابن أبي حاتم. أبو حاتم هذا مفسر معروف صاحب كتاب الجرح والتعديل. ابنه عبد الرحمن لما سئل هل فاتك شيء من علم أبيك؟ فقال لا. قيل له كيف ذلك؟ قال حتى وهو بالخلاء أقرأ عليه كتابا. حتى وهو في الخلاء لا يتكلم يقول أنا أقرأ عليه كتابا في كل شيء. يعني هذا ابن يعني المفسر ابن حاتم ابنه عبد الرحمن يقول في كل لحظة أقرأ على أبي كتاب. ماذا حدث له هذا عبد الرحمن؟ كان مسافرا مع اثنين من أصحابه، والسفر يسمى الرحلة في طلب الحديث، وكانوا يسافرون لطلب الحديث. فيقول كنا في بلد لم نأكل فيها يعني أكلا شهيا أبدا، يقول حتى اشتهينا أن نأكل سمكة، نشتري سمكة وبالليل يعني نطبخها ونأكلها. يقول جدولنا باليوم كالتالي: في الصباح في محاضرات عند الشيوخ، الساعة 8 محاضرة مثلا، 9 محاضرة، يعني من شيخ إلى شيخ. يقول في الصباح نسمع الأحاديث ونتلقى العلم، وفي المساء نقابل النسخ، قد يكون إنسان فاته كلمة يأخذ من صاحبه، يعني يقابلون ماذا ما كتبوه حتى يتأكدوا أن الكتابة كلها صحيحة. يقول ذات يوم غاب أحد الشيوخ وكان مريضا. الشيخ واضح أنت معي؟
أيوة.
كان مريضا هذا الشيخ. يقول فكانت فرصة حتى نذهب نشتري سمكة، ما كان في وقت أبدا. قال اشترينا سمكة فأتينا بها البيت، وإذا قد حضر وقت المحاضرة الثانية. فيقول ما بهرناها ولا ملحناها ولا شيء أبدا، وكانت السمكة أمامنا. نذهب في الصباح ونرجع بالليل، ننظر إلى السمكة ولا نشتهي ولا نأكل. يقول حتى اضطررنا أن نأكلها نية، أكلناها بدون شوي يا شيخ. يرون السمكة يشتهونها ولا ما في وقت حتى يشونها.
From the stories, Ikhwani, of the Salaf that the Shaykh wanted to share with you when he was talking about the last and the 10th point, that how we have to read and come to know about what the Salaf used to go through to get knowledge, the pains that they used to go through, and times were tough back then, is an incident or two incidents with a great muhaddith of this ummah. He is the son of Ibn Abi Hatim. Ibn Abi Hatim is one of the ulama of al-hadith. He has a son, his name is Abdurrahman. He wrote the book Kitab al-Jarh wa Ta'dil, serious book in knowledge. They said to Abdurrahman Ibn Abi Hatim, did you miss anything from your father's knowledge? You're his son. And he was really serious. Did you miss any knowledge from him? He said, wallahi, no, I didn't miss any knowledge from my father. Even when my father used to go to relieve himself, akramakum Allah, I used to read to him. Not my father reading to me. My father was quiet, but I was reading, showing that every single minute, every single moment, he was studying with his father. So when they asked him, did you miss any knowledge? He said, I didn't miss any knowledge, to the point where this is how it was between me and my father. May Allah give us fathers like that and sons like that. He went on to mention another story where Abdurrahman ibn Abi Hatim went out to get knowledge along with other people from the ulama of al-hadith. And he had two companions who were with him in this particular trip. And when they went to that trip, they used to be extremely busy. In the daytime, they would go to this sheikh 8 o'clock, to the next sheikh 9 o'clock, to the next one 10, 11, 12. And that's how they spent the morning. And then in the evening time, the students will come together and they will compare what they wrote. You wrote something, he wrote. So they would want to make sure that what they wrote was the same. Maybe you missed one word, he missed a word. Like I'm translating, someone else is translating. They say, you missed that word. And that's what they used to do every day. He said, then it happened where we wanted to eat some fish. We wanted to eat fish. But because of the schedule, it was difficult to eat fish. There's no time. In the morning time, you're going through the classes. In the night time, you have to sit together to compare the notes. So one day, there was one of the sheikhs of the morning time who became sick, and he couldn't attend the dars. So they said, hey, let's take this opportunity. Let's go get that fish. So they went and they purchased the fish. When they brought the fish back, it was time for the next class. So the next class came, they went with that sheikh, and then it kept happening. And the fish was there. And then they decided, because they had no other alternative, because there was no time, they decided to do what? They just ate the fish raw without cooking it, because the fish was gonna spoil, and there was no time. So they just wound up eating the fish without being cooked in any way, because that's just the way their time. They had no time except for knowledge.
الإمام ابن عقيل الحنبلي المعروف المشهور له كلمة تدل على حرصه على طلب العلم وعلى أن وقته ثمين. يعني الوقت كيف يكون ثمين عند بعض الناس؟ للأسف إخواني، الشخص الملتزم طالب العلم لا ينبغي أن يقول أنا فارغ. الفارغ يعمل يسبح يهلل. ما المسلم لا الطاعة لا حدود لها. ماكو شيء اسمه فارغ. لابد أن تعمل. هذا الشيخ كان حريصا على كل لحظات وقته. طيب ماذا كان يصنع؟ انتبه ماذا كان يقول. يقول كنت حريصا أشد الحرص على وقتي حتى إنني انتبه أقدم أو أفضل سف الكعك على مضغ الخبز. احنا اشرح لك يا شيخ. هذا الإناء فيه ماء، يأتي بالكعك يضعه هنا في الماء.
ايش الكعك؟
كعك البخت. احنا شو تسمونه اقصد بكانون؟ ليس كيك.
ليس كيك
من. زي البسكوت. زي البسكوت. زي البسكوت.
أوكي.
طيب يضع هنا في الماء حتى يذوب وهو يقرأ، ثم يأخذ يقول ويأكل حتى لا يمضغ المضغ الخبز. انتبه الخبز الآن، ها هكذا خبز الآن، خبز البريد يقطع ثم يأخذ ثم يأكل يمضغ. كم يأخذها معه في خمس دقائق؟ فيقول أقدم سف الكعك على مضغ الخبز. هذا وقت طويل يقول.
يلا كمل. طيب from the stories إخواني that we will find amongst the actions of our Salaf al-Salih رضي الله عنهم ورحمهم الله أجمعين is that there's a story that comes to us from the great Hanbali scholar who was مشهور معروف Ibn al-Aqil. Ibn Aqil. This man, he wanted to show how serious time was to him, his time. The Sheikh said, the people of the past used to really have hirs on their time. They paid attention. It was expensive to them. Whereas right now, many of the people, the time doesn't mean anything to them. His time is just there to be wasted. A Muslim never says, I'm free. I'm farigh. I don't have anything to do. Because at-ta'a, worshiping Allah Azza wa Jal, it has no had. There's always something to do for a person when it comes to worshiping Allah and obeying Allah. Anyway, this particular man, Ibn Aqil al-Hanbali, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he said about himself, he said, I used to value my time so much that I would take one of those, we can't call it a cake, but it's a long, it's like a cake thing, like a biscuit, a cracker, like a cracker. He said, I would take a cracker and I would dip the cracker in the water. And then as the Sheikh showed, he would go and he would eat it like that. Why would he do that? The Sheikh said, now why would he do that is the question. He said the reason why he would do that, put a cracker in water, is because if he were to get bread, for an example, and you get the piece of bread and you dip it in something, you have to dip it, you have to chew it, and then you have to swallow it. He said this takes time. He didn't have time for that. So he would put the thing until it melted inside of the cup, and then he would take it and go just to save time. So that's an indication of the seriousness of how the Salaf used to look at their time when it came to طلب العلم.
جزاك الله خير. الآن أود بس ودنا الشيخ لو تعيد لهم الآن عشر الوصايا هذه.
The Sheikh said,
انتهينا إن شاء الله.
Anybody wants to name the 10 that he mentioned? Can anybody name the 10 that are mentioned?
تفضل شيخ. نعم؟ ما اسمع سبب ايش؟ قول ما فهمت شنو السؤال.
يعني كأنه يقول يستطيع يذكر بعدها.
طيب يلا تفضل.
تفضل.
نعم تلك عشرة كاملة. نعم. أول شيء أهم شيء هذا. أيوة. تمام. أن يطلب العلم عند صاحب السنة. نعم. الحفظ. نعم ما شاء الله. نعم. ليس شرط الترتيب أنت الذي تقوله قوله نعم أربعة وين خربعة مستعيل نعم لا هذا من الحفظ هذا أمور معينة على الحفظ نعم ال طيب نعم الارتباط العلماء كبار صح لا طيب شنو دخل هذا لا تتكلم الا بعلمه ايه طيب بعدكم اكو احدكم من غيره
Anybody else want to help this sheikh? He got five of them, half of them. Any of you younger brothers want to help? Tafadhal ya akhi Kareem.
Stay
connected with the Yeah, you want to help him finish the rest? Yeah, he mentioned that.
Yes. Ghera, another.
To act upon it, naam, al-amal bihi.
Al-amal, naam. تمام بعد طيب الاخيره ما تذكر الاخيره اخر واحده قريبه من قريبه العهد من المحاضره
he just mentioned some just recently I mean just a few minutes ago
ها جدول نعم ترتيب العلم ترتيب الطلب
anybody else اخواني all of you guys are looking that's it anybody else
هذا من الأمور معينة على الحفظ هذا أسباب ما شاء الله أنت تذكرت الأسباب الفرعية ونسيت الأسباب الأصلية تفضل said it before
it was said already
yes طيب نختم شيء نختم
نختم
لكن والله نختم نعم نعم الاستمرار حتى تلقى الله العلم ليس له نهاية ليس له حد كالبحر لا حد له لا ساحل له طيب علو الهمة نعم وقراءة قراءة سير الصحابة والتابعين في طلب العلم حتى تأخذ تسير على دربهم تتشجع